there was an email sent out last week, and I'm sending a reminder email today. So just check that out. It's like a 10-second Google form to fill out. It really helped. If you can get rid of your old gear if you want it, and then also my students save some money. So thanks. Welcome to the last environmental engineering seminar of what turned out to be an amazing and memorable semester. I think that, you know, maybe it's just my bias because I thought so many talks were interesting to me personally, but I think this has been one of the most interesting and enjoyable and compelling series that we've had in many years. And I want everyone to give thanks to the organizers. So let's see, Rachel and Emily. So stand up, the three of you, because you've done a great job. And I can think of no better way to end the semester than with one of our own students and very few students who compare to Joe Chardonnay. So, you know, any of you who are here saw Ed Colosiak, you know that anyone who finishes a PhD in my group is a very compelling speaker. But, and of course, they're excellent researchers. They have a sense of humor because they've learned to write papers with me. And they're very patient. And so there are many things that I can't really rank my students relative to one another. But I can say that in Joe's case, he's quite exceptional as a speaker, because he's the only student I've ever known that keeps winning awards for outstanding presentations. So first it was the NSF Engineering Research Center's Perfect Pitch Competition, or the Lynn Preston Award in Tattoo. I'll show you the tattoo later if you ask. And then there's what are the names of these two that you just won? The first one, Grad Slams. The Grad Slams, and then the People's Choice, and then you're giving the commencement speech in engineering. So any of you who are master students, please stay awake during your graduation. Don't go out too late and get to see Joe give a talk. And so you have another chance to see Joe. But I, in order to do this, I'm going to present Joe with an award. It's the ESNT Memorial Laser Pointer. Plus, I want Joe to keep giving presentations during the rest of his career. You can see the patented green laser. It's strong enough to cut through a person, so pay attention. It's not attached to your body at the end of the second. Shapeless, like water. Then you put water in a cup, and it becomes the cup. You put it into a bottle, and it becomes the bottle. You put it into a teapot, and it becomes the teapot. Now water can flow, or it can crash. Be like water, my friend. Bruce Lee. Now Bruce was probably talking about Kung Fu, but it's interesting how applicable that quote is to the way we handle water in a modern urban environment. In a place where water becomes so many different things, and virtually all of those are because of the way we handle it. What containers do we put it in? This beautiful, formless, shapeless thing. We can turn it into something that flows and is valuable. We can turn it into something that crashes and is not. And I hope that through my presentation today, you'll see how in my PhD, I've worked to transform water into a beautiful, flowing, useful substance that we can use across our urban environments. And I'd like to start out by talking about the really complicated relationship that we have with water in our mega cities that we built all across the American West, basically in deserts. And these cities are addicted to importing their water supply from across the state and across the country. And this is a really big problem for these cities. The first problem with this is that it's super expensive. Los Angeles spent $200 million importing their water in 2016, which was not a drought year, right? This is an every year problem. Spent over $200 million importing their water, and that was a big improvement. The mayor is actually really working on bringing this number down. It was over $100 million higher than that in 2014. The second reason this addiction to water imported from long distances is a big problem is the energy cost of moving all this water. The State Water Project is the single largest user of electricity in the entire state of California as it pumps water from Northern California up and over the Tehachapi Mountains and into Southern California. This is insane. And in a state where the electorate really cares a lot about the environment and the politicians really pretend to care about the environment, this kind of energy use is a huge problem, right? We're spending so much carbon to get our water. And especially if you're reliant on other cities to sell you water, when there's a drought, they're not going to be selling their water. So there's a huge issue of water security here, and it's not just a drought year problem. This addiction to imported water is super ironic when you consider another type of water we deal with in urban settings, stormwater. You see, as we build our cities out, we cover their areas with impermeable surfaces, which means when it rains, we get massive wet weather flows. This is a huge problem in places like the Sun Valley, where we have a field site, and the stormwater infrastructure is totally insufficient. They have huge flooding problems. And there's an interesting environmental justice aspect here, because I don't have to tell you the skin color of the people that live in this neighborhood. You already know. It's also a big problem in places with combined sewers, like Sacramento and San Francisco, because when you get a big rainstorm, you can have a combined sewer overflow. And so you are probably sitting there thinking, well, I mean, we've got a problem and a solution right here, right? Let's just use our stormwater, which is a local water source, to augment our water supply. And there you go, problem solved. But it's never that easy, right? If it was that easy, my PhD would have been done a long time ago, right? Joni Mitchell could have done my PhD, right? She could have been like, don't it always seem to go? You don't know what you got till it's gone. You pay paradise, you put up a parking lot. No, right? But it's never that easy, right? There's a huge complication, and that there is crap in our gutters besides water. Like mineral crap in some cases, but also herbicides, pesticides, tire and brake wear products, metals, all of these things that we really don't want in our drinking water supply. And these hazards hold back this potential amazing use for stormwater. And so there needs to be some way to address this. If we're gonna save this water, we have to remove the contamination. And you might be thinking, well, you know, I've seen these like bioswales and rain gardens in the parking lot and Safeway. I thought this exists, and it's true. We do build things like this around our urban environment, but these things are really, really small. If you're just collecting the rain coming off of a parking lot, that's tiny in comparison to the hundreds of thousands of acre feet of water that cities are importing every year. Now, an acre foot is about the amount of water that a family of four uses in a typical year. Right, so massive amounts of water. What's coming off of a single parking lot is less than a drop in the bucket there. Also, these systems, they're designed, they're called best management practices, but I think they're kind of adequate management practices. There's no concern about the stormwater quality at all. They say, okay, well, we'll just infiltrate it as quickly as possible because we want to get rid of stormwater, and you know, maybe we'll put some mulch in there, and some microbes will grow, and there'll be filtration, and good things will happen, right? That's not engineering, right? That's how engineering maybe worked in the 19th century. It's not 21st century engineering. I call this approach to stormwater the Lazy Jane approach because of the Shel Silverstein poem. Lazy, 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 lazy Jane. She wants a drink of water, so she waits and waits and waits and waits and waits for it to rain. We're sitting here with these tiny capture areas, hoping that the little bit of water that does fall into them is high enough quality that we can drink it. This is ridiculous. This is not how engineering should work. So in my PhD, I'm studying a more realistic solution to this problem. Centralized systems, where we would collect large, whole neighborhoods worth of stormwater into a single area, like the Rory Shaw wetlands that are being built in the Sun Valley, a 45-acre pit with the capacity to recharge 900 acre feet of water per year. Now we're talking, and we're gonna fill these pits with a technology that passively treats the contaminants in the stormwater as they infiltrate through, right? So it's gonna be very low energy, it's gonna be very cost effective, and it's actually gonna apply science and engineering to solving the problems that we care about, which is this water is not fit to be drunk. So what does this look like from an engineering standpoint? Well, in my research center, we love to think about unit processes, right? So we got a treatment train of all kinds of different technologies, and we can tailor this suite of treatment to the suite of contaminants that we see in the stormwater in any given area. So you might have something that looks like an open water wetland. You can have different kinds of filters to treat nutrients coming into your water if nutrients are concerned. You can have biochar to absorb the hydrophobic compounds. But the focus of my PhD in this presentation today is on a material called manganese oxide. So now, probably many of you have not heard about manganese oxide because it's confusingly similar to magnesium. Magnesium is a completely different element. That's element number 12. I'm speaking to element number 25, manganese. Everyone on my committee has confused magnesium and manganese at some point, so it's okay if you do it too, but they're completely different elements. And it's funny that you've probably heard of never heard of manganese oxide, because I guarantee you have some stuck on the bottom of your shoe right now, because it's in dirt, right? It's a very common constituent in dirt. However, manganese oxides are this really incredible class of minerals, and that they exist in all these different crystal flavors, all these different structures that consist of manganese in the plus 4, plus 3, and plus 2 oxidation stage. Right, so you get these really highly crystalline forms here, like pyrolusite. You get bernasite, which occurs in these layers and microbes, make those. You get cryptomalane, which has this tunnel-shaped morphology here, and we'll talk more about cryptomalane in a little bit. But one thing that all of these different flavors have in common is that they have this neat property where they're redox active. So they will react with organic carbon and undergo a reduction, right? So manganese 4 gets reduced to manganese 3, manganese 3 gets reduced to manganese 2, which is a soluble form of manganese, so you do see some reductive dissolution. Manganese oxides also have this interesting property where they tend to have a low zero point of charge. So if you have a low zero point, who is in my class? Emily, you are in my class. All right, so if you have a low zero point of charge, what will the surface charge be at a neutral pH, positive or negative? Negative, right? That's right. Give it up for Emily. If it were not that long, they would have taken away my teaching award, so I'm going to say that too. No, right, so they can be negatively charged, so they can absorb metal cations, which are also a big problem in stormwater. Right, so the soil scientists have told us, you know, 30 or 40 years ago, that these materials have really interesting properties. The question now is, can we engineer them? And so, I coated manganese oxides on the surfaces of sand, and you can see I've got some of my manganese oxide coated sand here. It looks like dirt, because again, it makes up dirt, so I can send that around. And I spent a lot of time in my PhD trying to figure out how to best coat sand with manganese oxide so that it won't wash away in these stormwater systems, and to generate a really reactive phase with a synthesis at low temperature, so you can do this in bulk. And I came up with something that doesn't actually have a whole lot of manganese on it. You can see in this picture the white parts are the manganese, so you can see it's just a thin, sort of spotty surface covering. But it doesn't take a lot to have a really powerful punch. And then I experimented with this to see how reactive it is with organic compounds first. And so we're curious about working in stormwater. So I'm going to tell you guys a dirty little secret about environmental chemistry here. There are a lot of environmental chemists that pretend they study chemistry in the environment, but actually they work in milky water buffered with like a really dilute buffer at pH 7. That is not what the environment looks like in any case, right? We're really interested in seeing if this could actually work in stormwater. I think that it's kind of valueless unless you're showing that it can work in the environment where it's going to be applied. But stormwater is a super variable matrix to work in, right? Because depending on geology, geography, you know, where you are just within a particular watershed, what stormwater is varies dramatically. So I do most of my experiments with simulated stormwater, which is a good approximation of like what the average stormwater is. And it has a high ionic strength. It has one millimolar carbonate. It has dissolved organic carbon in it. And so in these ways, we can really understand how these manganese oxides would work in an authentic stormwater setting. So I did two kinds of tests. I did batch tests, and I will show what the batch tests are on future slides with this little symbol here of a vial, where I put stormwater contaminated with something in with some sand and shook it around in a vial. And these are good screening tests. Then I also did column tests, where I pumped water through at a flow rate of about 9 centimeters per hour. So that's like 8 feet per day, for those of you guys that prefer units in the king's foot. And so that's like an authentic flow rate through these systems, and gives us a more realistic understanding of how infiltration systems would work. So I screened these different organic contaminants for reactivity, and I found that there's sort of a spectrum of reactivity among different organic contaminants that we might find in stormwater. So some things are really reactive, right? So things that have thiol groups or phenolic groups or anilines, these groups tend to make compounds very, very reactive. This is because, so someone that's taking 217, Rachel, are these electron donating or withdrawing groups? They're electron donating groups, right? So electron donating groups tend to activate the ring with a little chemical intuition. That's exactly what you'd expect, right? They're Lewis bases, they want to give up those electrons. Then you've got something like diiron that does have an electron donating group, but its reactivity is not as fast as these other compounds, and that's because it's also got electron withdrawing groups. There are other compounds that are moderately active, like pyrene. So, got a minor in public health here, because I don't want to brag. Public health pro tip here, if it looks like chicken wire, it's probably bad for you. But another thing about these PAHs is that they have a very even distribution of pi electrons, so there's no sort of obvious point of attack for the oxidants, so that sort of slows down their reactivity. And then you got things like fipronil, this is frontline plus, right, so next time you put this on the dog, recognize you're poisoning all of us. these guys are not reactive at all. And so, instead of treating these with manganese oxides like you could with the other contaminants, you might want to look at treating these with something sorptive, like biochar. But in any case, this is a really exciting finding, right? Things react with stormwater that we care about, we can remove the toxicity, and it happens in a realistic matrix. However, we have to consider how long this reaction lasts, because before municipalities are going to apply this technology, they want to make sure that it's not going to go away after one rainstorm. So I did column tests over a long period of time to really try and test how long this reactivity lasted. I used a big concentration of BPA as a model contaminant, one because, you know, it's an endocrine disruptor, it's ubiquitous in plastics, and so we care about it in stormwater, but also we understand its reactivity really well. So this is what it looked like over time. So on the x-axis here, we have pore volumes. You can think about that as the amount of water that flowed through this system, or time, if you prefer. We have the amount of BPA removed by the manganese oxide coated sand on the y-axis. So you can see, initially, we get really, really good reactivity, and we're removing all of the BPA. But over time, this performance decreases, decreases, decreases. And so this is kind of an interesting finding. That, you know, we'd expect that this stuff wouldn't last forever, but can this tell us something about the real world? So if we extrapolate it to a full-size system, we can project that before you saw failure, according to the mechanism that I'm observing here, if you wanted to see at least 80% removal of the reactive organic compounds, you'd get a lifetime of about 45 years, which is pretty good. If you wanted to remove at least half of the reactive organic compounds, you'd get a lifetime of about 80 years. And if you wanted to really get all the reactivity out of this system, you're super stingy with it, you'd get a lifetime of over 100 years from this system. Now, I don't think that realistically this system can last for over 100 years because this is just one failing mechanism and there might be problems with clogging or other things like that that could limit the effectiveness of this system. But this is a really cool finding too. It shows that this system has legs, that it's applicable in a real time span, can last season over season for a city that's interested in turning their stormwater into a local resource. But you do lose reactivity over time, and especially if you've got stormwater that's got a heavy load of organics, you're going to lose that reactivity and be in trouble. And so let's real talk here. You guys like these superhero movies that are coming out? Right? There was like a superhero movie that came out like yesterday. It was like The Avengers Part Infinity or whatever. I'm not a big fan of superheroes. I think in part because the only superhero I ever loved when I was a kid was this guy. You know this guy? Math Blaster? Any Math Blaster fans out there? No? No, it's Math Blaster. Yeah! So Math Blaster was this awesome like alien, and he would fly around defeating evil, but eventually he lost his powers, and in order to restore these powers, you had to do math problems. The more math problems you did, the more you restored his power. And this was perfect for a nerdy kid like me. I dressed up like Math Blaster. My parents are taking this picture, and they're like, oh my god, our son is going to die a virgin. But this principle exists, right? When you've got something with superpowers, right? Be it Math Blaster or manganese oxide coated sands, and eventually it loses its powers. So is there some way that we can do math problems to restore the oxidative superpowers of the failed manganese oxide coated sands? So I did some experiments. I took some of the failed sand columns, and I took the sand out of them, and I treated them in batch with a bunch of different chemical oxidants, with permanganate, with peroxide, with taurine. And then I took that sand that was maybe regenerated and put it into batch experiments and tested how reactive it was with bisphenol A. And so these are the results of that. You can see on the x-axis I have all the different treatments I applied to the sand to try and regenerate it. And on the y-axis I have reactivity here. So if you don't like reaction rate constants, just ignore the units. It's reactivity here on the y-axis. And to help orient you can see the red line is the virgin media to sort of give you a reference, very reactive. And the green line is the failed media, so almost zero reactivity. And you can see, excitingly, that some of these oxidants did restore the reactivity, not just a little bit, but all the way to levels comparable to that of the virgin material. So this was a pretty cool finding. And especially reactive or especially effective rather, were the hypohalites. So chlorine, bromine, and a mixture of chlorine and bromine. So they said, okay, this is the promising chemical finding. What about the dosing? Does the concentration of the oxidant that I add make a difference? And so I calculated the stoichiometric ratio that was required to oxidize all of the manganese oxide that it's in its failed state, its more reduced state, back up to manganese 4, back up to NnO2. And that's sort of the electron demand, the stoichiometric electron demand. And I dosed along that sort of gradient of electron demand. Again, you can see reactivity here on the y-axis. And you can see that if you underdose it, you don't really restore very much reactivity. But when you start meeting stoichiometric demand or exceeding it, you get that reactivity that's comparable to that of the virgin media. However, overdosing it too much, if you go 10 times more, you don't get 10 times more reactivity. So your best bet is just to sort of use a stoichiometric dose. And that's important, right? So you guys that are going to be controlling our water supply soon here should know that anytime you think about chlorine, right, you should be worried about disinfection byproducts. You know, trihalomethanes and haloacetic acids. Anytime you're working with chlorine, those could be an issue. So understanding proper chlorine dosing, very important. So this is an exciting batch finding, but again, the proof is in column experiments. So I did some column experiments where I pumped some chlorine through the system. Remember, chemists refer to these HOCl as chlorine, right? It's a little bit confusing. It's hypochloric acid, but it's also chlorine. So pump some chlorine through the system and measure what's coming out, see how effective it is. So let's just look at the chlorine that comes out during regeneration here. So here's the pore volumes, the amount of chlorine that I'm pumping through the system over time, and I meet stoichiometric demand after 50 pore volumes here. On the y-axis, you have the fraction of the chlorine that I've put in that is coming out at the end. So you can see, initially, all of the chlorine that I put in is being consumed by the manganese here. It's all being converted into chloride ion, right? But then, at the end, all of the chlorine that I put in is coming out still as chlorine. And so there's like a step function in between the two of these when you meet stoichiometric demand, which tells me that the reduced forms of manganese, manganese 2 and manganese 3, that's still sticking around my column, is a highly effective scavenger of chlorine, which means we can dose this system very precisely without having a lot of excess chlorine come out. We can really control for those disinfection byproducts. But does it work for restoring the reactivity of this system? And that's really important, right? Because for a lot of these cities that are looking to apply these things, the major cost concern for them is in the maintenance and regeneration of this system. So if you can get out there with machines and backhoes and people and dig all this stuff out to regenerate it, it's worthless, right? That's so expensive for cities. But if you can regenerate it in situ, that saves cities a lot of money. So let's see. So just to remind you, this is what the virgin media did. So failed at about 1,300 pore volumes. And then I regenerated for 250 pore volumes. And then I'm going to reset the clock. So we're going to start again at zero so we can compare apples to apples, virgin and regenerated media. As you can see, the regenerated media had a lifetime almost nearly as long as the virgin media. And interestingly, it even had better performance in sort of the middle of its lifetime. So this is a really exciting finding, right? You can regenerate the amazing properties of this system, just like Math Blaster, right? You can regenerate these properties, and it performs just as good as me. So that's a really cool finding, but it's very empirical, right? And you know, for any of you guys that have worked with David, you know, that's not going to cut it, right? Like, a good PhD doesn't just show what happens, it also explains why. So we need to understand why does this happen. So I did some analysis of the media over this treatment regeneration cycle. So you can see here, I got four volumes again through one treatment regeneration cycle. And I'm highlighting the virgin media, the failed media, the regenerated media, and I took some intermediate samples of it too. In the top graph, here's the coating density, the amount of manganese that's on the manganese oxide coated sands. And you can see that initially, I've got a coating density of about 2 milligrams of manganese per gram of media. And by the end of one treatment regeneration cycle, I actually lose a quarter of that coating. However, that regenerated media still has an incredibly long lifetime, is still incredibly reactive. So this is a really interesting finding, right? It tells us that reactivity and reactive longevity aren't necessarily closely related to the coating density of the manganese on the media. So that's kind of cool. Another interesting thing that we found was looking at the oxidation state. So remember, right, manganese oxide is manganese in the 4+ state, and the bottom of the spectrum is manganese 2, where it dissolves away. So the average oxidation state of the virgin media is about 3.95. So that's, you know, pretty high. That's about as high as we can get. it drops, but it only drops down to about 3.75. So just a small change in the electronic structure of this mineral makes a profound difference in the reactivity. This is a really, really unexpected finding. I was expecting to have to drop the average oxidation state a lot more, but no, just subtle changes in the electronic structure make a huge difference. And then we look at regeneration again. The regenerated sample that I took sort of halfway through when I reached stoichiometric dosing had already achieved that maximum oxidation state. So that sort of corroborates what we were already thinking, that you don't need to overdose this system. You can be judicious and still get the full benefit. Now, this is really good, but the soil scientists and the material scientists that look at this stuff, they're like Alexander Hamilton, they will never be satisfied. So they look at this and they say, you know what you should really do? You should go completely out of your department. You should find some x-rays to shoot at this stuff. I don't know where to do that, but I looked around and I was able to do some x-ray diffraction. So are there any physicists or material scientists in this room? Right? If you could cover your ears for the next 5 minutes, because this is going to be an abomination. The way x-ray diffraction works is you shoot x-rays at a mineral sample, and if the planes of atoms lined up in this mineral are in these nice even planes that are evenly spaced, they act like semi-reflective mirrors, and you get constructive interference bouncing off of these planes that gives you these really distinct peaks that stick way up above the background. You get a very distinct crystal structure from this X-ray diffraction pattern. If you don't have that nice even alignment, you have a nanocrystalline structure or an X-ray amorphous structure, you get really high background and no peaks. So I ran X-ray diffraction on all of my manganese oxides, and you can see virgin, regenerated, and failed media, none of these have incredibly high peaks sticking up above the background. But the virgin media and the regenerated media, the reactive stuff, have much, much higher backgrounds relative to the signal to the failed media. And the failed media, we do start to see some diffraction peaks starting to stick out here. So this is interesting. Maybe the failed media, the unreactive stuff, is developing more of a crystal structure. Now, this is a pretty cool finding, that reactivity may be inversely proportional to the reactive or the long-range order of the crystal structure. And if we look at what crystal could this be that's forming, I'm going to overlay sort of the textbook example of what Crypto-Mullane's X-ray diffraction pattern should look like. And look at that. The peaks line up perfectly. So it's not like perfect Crypto-Mullane for sure, but we're starting to form something that looks a lot like pure Crypto-Mullane. And that, you know, it shouldn't be surprising that it's Crypto-Mullane, because the synthesis method that I worked with was for Crypto-Mullane, but it's surprising that there's this inverse relationship between reactivity. Now, again, these material scientists, they can never be satisfied, right? So they said, you know what? You should get some even more difficult to obtain x-rays and shoot them at this signal. Can you, like, go to the surface of the sun to get these x-rays? Like, oh my goodness. So did something called x-ray absorption spectroscopy. So the principle for x-ray absorption spectroscopy is you shoot x-rays out of an atom and cause that atom to vibrate. This is very much akin to taking a stone and throwing it into water. It'll send ripples of waves across the pond, right? If you took a really big rock and threw it really hard, you could create waves that were big enough that if there were buoys sitting on the surface of that pond, they would bob up and down too and send out waves also. Then you look at all of the waves that are crashing on, in this case, the atomic beach, right? And you look at this wave signal, and you back calculate the position of all of those buoys, in this case, all of those atoms. It is an incredibly cool technology. It's like hearing a guitar chord play and knowing not just what notes were played, but how far apart the strings are from each other. But in order to do this, you have to take an X-ray and shoot it really, really freaking hard at an atom to make it vibrate this much. And so in order to do this, you need a synchrotron. Right? So I went to Stanford, the synchrotron radiation light source there, and what they do is they accelerate electrons around. And so if you don't remember from your high school class, which I'm sure you don't, because I do, when you accelerate a charged particle, you send out a photon in a tangential direction to that acceleration. So if you spin these electrons around at the speed of light, you're sending out x-rays down beam lines all around the circle that are incredibly powerful. And if you sweep across a bunch of energies with these x-rays, you get patterns that look like this when you hit atoms. And so there are two kinds of different patterns that material scientists and physicists look at. We have confusingly similar names. You get the Zanes structure, or the straight part. The Zanes area is used mainly for looking at average oxidation states of your materials. And then you get the X-axis area, or the wiggly part. The wiggly part is more useful for looking at the geometries of the atoms, where they are relative to each other. So I did this X-ray absorption spectroscopy, and these are results from the Zanes. So you can see sweeping across a bunch of energies here, and I've got the absorption for some standards that I compared, of pure manganese 2, 3, and 4, and then for my virgin failed and regenerated media. And we can do sort of matches, we can do a fit to see how much manganese 3, 4, and 2 are present in this system. And you can see that this really matches up with the wet chemistry very well. So all of this work that I did was basically telling me what I already knew, that we've got a lot of manganese 4 around there. However, there is a significant increase in the amount of manganese 3 that's present in this system. So this can maybe give us some insight into why we see this inverse relationship between crystallinity and reactivity. It could be that manganese 3 is getting into the interlayer of the Bravais lattice of these crystals and limiting their reactivity that way. You could see some, like, yeah, we'll get into it. There's like non-color distortion maybe happening here. And so you could see limited reactivity because of this small but very significant increase of manganese 3 happening. We can also look at the x-axis structure. And so this is, the x-axis here is basically energy. It's expressed as wave number, but you can think of it as energy. And again, on the y-axis, we have basically absorption. So I have a bunch of standards here, standards of manganese oxide, my pure manganese oxidation state standards, and then my samples. So there's a couple of features. I know this is really confusing. There's a couple of features that are worth looking at. The first is the staircase, as it's called, that starts at a wave number around 4. And this staircase is a signature of manganese oxides. You see, all manganese oxides have a staircase. So I did this experiment, I spent all this time, I didn't sleep for 40 hours to determine that my samples do in fact contain manganese oxides. Right? Profound science. Your tax dollars at work, ladies and gentlemen. Another sort of distinguishing feature is this peak that we see at a wave number around 6.5 and 7. But you'll notice that mine sort of have this weird asymmetry to them. It's not like a plateau, it's not like a symmetrical peak, it's sort of like humpbacked. And again, that's something that we see in cryptomalane. So we probably got some cryptomalane forming. And then you can do some neat quantitative stuff with XAS, but if you're just looking at qualitative things, it's sort of like squint, and like if you squint long enough and get desperate to graduate, like features start to pop out at you. So if this next one, if the next one you don't see, that's okay. Like trade glasses with the person next to you, and maybe you'll see it. So there's this double beat feature in cryptomalane here at around a wave number of 7.5 and 8. And I don't really see that double beat in the virgin media. I see it though in the failed media, right? So maybe we're getting something more like cryptomalane, and then I don't see it as much again in the regenerated. So again, there's this relationship between crystallinity. As you get more like cryptomalane, you get less reactive. All right, so what's the technique? This isn't what working in a beam line looks like. It's actually pretty cool. What do we take away about the potential for manganese oxide to treat organic stormwater contaminants? First of all, these materials have incredible properties where they can remove contaminants that we care about from stormwater over a long period. Secondly, we can regenerate that incredible property without having to beat up the material, saving cities tons of money and energy. And third, we kind of learned something interesting about like a more fundamental thing here, which I think is pretty cool, because I was totally working outside of my comfort zone for an organic chemist and an engineer here. But we learned that subtle mineralogy changes, changes in crystal structure, and slight changes in oxidation state can have a huge difference in reactivity. And this is something that we don't understand very well for manganese oxides. It's not like iron oxide, so this is a cool finding. However, this is just one part of the picture, right? We also care about metals in stormwater, and we think that manganese oxides can do a good job with those too. And so this really is a big area of problem in industry-impacted area because of the human and ecotoxicity of different metals. So who is in my class? All right, so Luis, you're in my class, right? So copper, do we care about it for human or ecotoxicity? Ecotoxicity, right? Very toxic to fish, not very toxic to humans. How about zinc? Eco, right? how about cadmium? Human, right? This one's an easy one, right? Lead, right? Yeah, not to say that lead isn't toxic to other species, but the human health burden of lead is pretty great, right? So there's a lot of things that give it up for Luis, by the way. So is this a problem in the areas we work? Well, yeah, it really is. So when we before we started our field site, we got this report that the sampling that they had done in the LA site, and somebody's like, this can't be real. 80 times the limit, like, it did something wrong. No, these are the real numbers. Like, at this level, like, zinc could actually be toxic to humans, right? It's a nutrient, but when you're 80 times over the limit, that's bonkers. So this is really something we need to figure out. So I started out again with batch experiments. We do an equilibrium isotherm. You guys remember equilibrium isotherms? So we sweep across a bunch of different concentrations, right? Think of activity as concentrations on the x-axis, and we see how much lead, so in this case it's lead pH, how much lead is stuck onto the material. And so we can build these isotherms, and if you're building an equilibrium isotherm, you gotta have a model, right? What are the different models that we can use for CIVA? What are the different models that we use for equilibrium isotherms? What are the two big ones?
Langmuir.
Langmuir and?
Langmuir.
Which one do you think this is? It's a Langmuir, right? So we can do a Langmuir fit there, and we can figure out what the Qmax is. And, you know, again, these are just sort of preliminary batch experiments, but just look at this number. It's really freaking high. Like, oh my god, we can absorb a lot of lead on this stuff. This is really promising. So, but then you gotta do the column experiments, right? So I did column experiments, and you can see experiments over about 458 hours here. Oh my god, these are long experiments. And I look at the amount of metal that I've removed. I'm just showing zinc and lead here, but we did a bunch of metals. And you can see that over time, we did see a decrease in the zinc, but man, the lead just stuck. The lead did not come off at all. This was a really, really interesting finding. And even with the zinc, we're looking at a lifetime of this system. I'm in the neighborhood of 25 years, right? So not only does this technology have staying power for its ability to treat organic compounds, it also has staying power for its ability to treat inorganic compounds. However, you do run into this problem with absorptive technologies, because with oxidative processes, like we're treating the organics with, you destroy the contaminant. But with sorptive processes, there's a potential for desorption. So I was curious, is there ways that we can regenerate this material and recover the metals so that there's no chance of it coming back off again? So we're going to do a deep cut here. You might remember that for any kind of an absorption process, if you get below a certain pH, things start to desorb. Anyone remember what that pH is when you get below, things start to disorb? It's like falling off a cliff. It's the absorption edge. So what if I get below the absorption edge of these metals? Do I start desorbing them, and can I recover them, right? So I decided to flush the columns with hydrochloric acid at pH 3. So this is a pretty mild acid, actually, right? Like, this is like orange juice level acidity. But we're seeing, can we recover the metals off of this material and regenerate it? And so you can see here, over 6 hours of treatment with pH 3, a ton of zinc is coming off, right? We're getting all of the zinc back. But like, look at the scale on this y-axis here, right? It wouldn't even show up if I plotted it on the same scale. Almost no lead is coming off. So this is really weird. What is going on here? Well, it could be, you know, you might remember, you probably don't remember, but you might remember that lead tends to have a very low absorption energy, so it might be that it's just not desorbing. That we need to get lower to get past that adsorption edge. However, there's another interesting possibility, which is that there's a similar mineral to cryptomelain that could be forming called coronadite. There could be a substitution reaction happening where lead is substituting in for manganese. They have the same Bravais lattice, so thermodynamically, this is a very feasible explanation. And lead could be substituting in, and it's not actually an adsorptive process. It's a substitution reaction. So that's an interesting thing that will happen. So what should be your takeaways for these metallic contaminants? So first of all, manganese oxides can sustain their effectiveness with metallic contaminants for a long time, and that we can recover most of these metals back with a mild acid wash. However, the performance does vary with the metals, and lead especially can be strung really strongly, and it's hard to. So I want to wrap up with a picture of a naked man. So we started with water in a cup. This is water in a bathtub. Does anyone know who this is? Deb, I know you know who this is. This is Archimedes, right? And so Archimedes is famous for this idea called Archimedes' principle. He was trying to figure out the volume of an irregularly shaped object, namely this crown. And he couldn't figure out, there's no mathematical formula for the area or for the volume of a crown. And as he was sitting there thinking about this problem, he got into his bathtub and realized that the water went up as he went down and eventually overflowed the bathtub. And he realized that an object in water displaces an equal volume of water. And he was so amazed by this incredible discovery that he made that he didn't even wait to put his clothes on. He ran through the streets of Syracuse. This is Syracuse, Greece, not Syracuse, New York. He ran through the streets of Syracuse, Greece, naked, screaming, "Eureka," which means, "I have found it." Right? This was an incredible discovery. Now, Peter Fiske here likes to say that scientists scientists and a lot of engineers should be predators. But respectfully, I disagree. I think that we need to be archaeologists. And in this department that I have the incredible privilege of working in, people are making incredible discoveries like this all the time. And I think it's our responsibility, and I hope that I contributed through, you know, my PhD research, to going out and saying, look at this amazing thing we found. Eureka, right? We're not going to take the time to put our clothes on. Okay, we will take the time to put our clothes on. But this is an incredible thing. We need to be champions of our work. We need to be going out and drumming up the support, drumming up the environment that is conducive for this technology, this incredible science that we're doing, to take root in our society. Because the things that we can do really can benefit the whole society. So with that, I have a lot of people that I really need to thank for help with me throughout my PhD. I want to thank my funding sources, Renewit and NSF. But I really want to thank Dave, first off, because you have been an incredible advisor to me. You've been so generous with me. Thank you so much for all of your help. I want to thank the entire SEDLAC group, all my coworkers, the Berkeley Water Center, and the O'Brien Lab. You guys have made this a really cool place to come to work every day, and I appreciate it. But especially among that group, I want to highlight the undergraduates that I had the chance to work with. Julian Rolfe, who started her PhD at Yale now. Frances Ledesma, who's finishing up at Cornell. And Yang Hong, I'm excited to say, is joining our group as a PhD student. These guys did a lot of the grunt work. They don't get enough credit for it, but they were amazing. I was not the mentor that they deserved, but I'm glad they're coming into their own as incredible scientists and engineers, each and every one of them. I want to thank my peer group, Jen, Rachel, and Karina. You guys were amazing. It was one of the best things I ever did in my PhD was teaming up with you guys. Your support for me, both professionally and personally, throughout, you know, every week we meet, and I get something good out of it. I get more than I give. Thank you so much. Likewise, I want to thank my Renewit peers, especially the people that produce the Why Are You Talking About podcast with me. Scott and Skylar and Zach have been there from the beginning. It's a really fun nerdy outlet. It's great to be able to share with you guys. I want to thank Shelly in particular. She helps all of the students here a lot, and she really does a lot for our department. But for me in particular, she helped me to rescind a master's degree that I was erroneously awarded that made me ineligible to receive the NSF fellowship. We figured out, I mean, it was a bureaucratic nightmare. And she and Mark Stacey sat down and figured out who we needed to call to get this degree rescinded so that I could be eligible to receive my fellowship. So you master's students that are about to take your comp exam, it is easier to accidentally get a degree than it is to get it taken. don't worry about it. But Rob, however much you were paying Shelley, it is not enough. She is doing incredible things for this department. I need to thank Elizabeth. It's incredible that nerdy kid dressed up as Nat Blaster was able to marry such a beautiful woman. You are a better partner and a better engineer than I will ever be. So thank you so much. I need to thank my dad, who's been an incredible role model, and most of all, my sister and my mom, who were respectively my first collaborator and my first PI. My mom is a science teacher and raised me in this household where science was so valuable. And we always were inquiring about things. One time, she was out and we had a babysitter, and a palmetto bug got in the house, which I don't know if you guys have ever seen a palmetto bug. It's like a Florida cockroach. It's like if a cockroach snorted bath salts, it would be a palmetto bug. So the babysitter is freaking out, right, and trying to squash the cockroach. But my mom had gotten my sister and I into insect collecting, like hardcore, like pinning it up with the like Latin name and all that stuff. And so she's trying to squash it, and my sister and I are like running around with a butterfly net, being like, no, we have to preserve sample integrity, right? And so I think that when you're raised in an environment where that level of scientific inquiry and appreciation for the world around you is just inculcated in you, it really pays dividends. And all this coming from my mom, who, you know, came to this country with nothing and hardly spoke English. And I think if that is not a testament to the fact that refugees and immigrants are precisely what made this country great, I don't know what is. And so with that, I will thank all of you. I'll put our meetings back up there, but it's making me a little uncomfortable. So.
Really underwhelmed. No, that was fantastic. I'm just wondering, did you do repeated regenerations? Because you saw that decline in the amount of magnesium. Manganese. did that level continue to drop, or was it just that one?
Yeah. So I tested that sand, the regenerated BD, all the way to failure again, and I did see a drop off in the amount of coated, but not nearly that same 25% that you saw the first time. And I think some of that has to do with physical attrition, right? So I think that when I coat the sand, there's, you know, little bits of manganese sticking off and things like that. And so those sort of things just sort of slough off physically. And once you get those off, then it's more of a chemical reductive dissolution process, and that's a much slower rate.
You mentioned that the density of the manganese oxide is decreasing after regeneration cycles.
Mm-hmm.
Do you have a sense for how many regeneration cycles your sand can endure?
That sort of follows along. You know, so I think it could sustain at least one more regeneration cycle just based on the trends that we're seeing. These experiments take months and months, so I did two and said, that's 200 years, like, call it good, but I get the sense that it could last for quite a while, actually. I think there's some interesting, so osmolal ripening is sort of the rapid dissolution and reprecipitation of minerals to get into like a lower energy state. And so there might be some osmolal ripening happening that sort of changes the distribution of manganese oxide around the sand. And that could be something interesting to study over time. But
yeah. I'm curious, along with all of the incredible like background science stuff that you did, if you were able to do any sort of cost analysis to compare what this would be to that $200 million
mm-hmm.
that you originally quoted as like cities spend this much money.
Yeah.
And how much money would this be saving cities?
Yeah, so like a quick back of the envelope estimation shows that this would be like preposterously expensive, but that's because I'm making tiny batches of this stuff in lab-grade chemicals. There are companies that produce other kinds of manganese oxide sand. It's something called manganese green sand. It's not very reactive with organics at all. They use it in like well water for treating high iron well water, but they produce it, you know, by the fertilizer bag full. So like clearly there is a capacity to produce this stuff in an economically feasible large scale way, or something at least very chemically similar to it. So I think it could be cost competitive. Yes.
So sort of along that note,
at
the start of your presentation by connecting us to the drinking water problem and talking about how green infrastructure is this really small kind of inadequate measures. And then you compared or you highlighted the Rory Shaw wetlands and the size of that. Do you have any sense of how big your intervention has to be in an urban area to make a difference towards the water supply kind of problem?
So ideally, every time we build one of these large scale things, I'd like to have my people, or at least where it's appropriate, right? Where the profile of contaminants fits the kind of things that we can treat. We can put manganese oxide to the same thing, or we can put biochar, or we can put functionalized clay, or something.
So what does this look like and how big it is? Are you imagining like a spreading ground kind of
thing? Yeah. So something along the lines of the spreading ground actually would be really about right. So in LA, they're buying up a lot of like old gravel pits and things like that, and there's a lot of spreading ground capacity right now that's just not used. And so LA is sort of a perfect store for this stuff because there's really a high demand, and also like the real estate prices work out where there's like all this spreading ground capacity that's unused and gravel pits that they're buying up. A lot of this work is funded by Proposition O, which was a $50 million bond measure. So I recognize that some of this stuff is, if we want to talk large scale, we sort of have to deal with the ridiculous real estate prices here, but I think that's what it takes to make it. Yeah.
Does manganese oxide have any competitors? Like any other compounds out there?
Yeah. So like one alternative to reacting away organic contaminants is just to sort them, right? So you could take biochar, which is cheap, and just absorb everything on biochar. There are a few problems with that. One is the possibility of desorption, and the other is that biochar tends to limit the hydraulic conductivity of these systems. So you can't put that much biochar in before the water stops flowing. So, you know, there are definitely other technologies that are in the hunt here. And, you know, mine has drawbacks and so on. Yeah.
So in addition to the technical feasibility, often in environmental remediation, there has to be a regulatory push. Does such a regulatory push exist right now? And if not, what would be your recommendations to, say, the Department of Water Resources in terms of new regulations?
Yeah, so unfortunately, the regulations are pretty far behind on this. Most of the stormwater regulations that exist are about quantities, not qualities. We they're just not in a place where we realize that we need to care about stormwater quality yet. In terms of looking at stormwater quality, though, I think that the biggest push is going to come actually from the Pacific Northwest. And we should see what they are going to do, because we're seeing problems like we had Ed's talk a couple weeks ago about the salmon kills, and that's directly related to something that's running off in the stormwater. So I think that where there's those economic leverage points will be where the first regulations start coming down. Yes?
To follow up on the size question, like I guess you said it would be that like 500 flow volumes equated to 81 meters.
Mm-hmm.
So that doesn't seem like it adds up in my mind when I'm thinking about like the size of a storm event, like this thing would have to be enormous.
Yeah. So one reason for that maybe non-linearity that you're seeing is that I was loading these with a way higher reactivity, or way higher level of organic contaminants than you would normally see, just because I wanted this to fail, you know, before I die. it would be really, really hard to get these problems to fail. So, you know, 5 micromolar EPA, that's probably 4 orders of magnitude higher than the amount of EPA that you would see in typical stormwater, and probably a couple orders of magnitude higher than just the reactive organic carbon that you would see in the system. So that might account for it. Yeah.
I think we're going to cut it off there. So join me again in thanking Joe for...